Hello and welcome to Jamie Ridler Studios, where creativity comes to life. I'm Jamie Ridler and I'm here today to share with you what is on my creative living bookshelf. I love every now and again sharing with you all of the books that I have picked up and have started reading. I just can't resist a good book, and I really encourage you to listen for those books that maybe have a little something special for you, particularly those ones that call you to show up more fully, more completely, more bravely in your creative life. And I think we'll see that this is a theme in the books that are currently on my bookshelf. And of course, I, like everybody else, am reading Big Magic by Elizabeth Gilbert. And the back just caught my eye as I started to pick this up, because I think if this resonates with you, you'll know whether this is a book that is meant for you. Creativity is sacred, and it's not sacred. What we make matters enormously, and it doesn't matter at all. We toil alone, and we are accompanied by spirits. We're terrified, and we are brave. Art is a crushing chore and a wonderful privilege. The work wants to be made, and it wants to be made through you. Do you know what work wants to be made through you? One of the things we need very much of in order to let that work come through is courage. There's a reason that the subtitle of Big Magic is Creative Living Beyond Fear. And Elizabeth Gilbert has started with this idea of the necessity of courage. And that coming out of her noticing that wherever creativity shows up, fear shows up too. She talks about having made the decision that creativity was going to be a part of her life. And so she knew she had to build an expansive enough interior life that her fear and her creativity could peacefully coexist, since it appeared that they would always be together. In fact, it seemed to me that my fear and my creativity are basically conjoined twins, as evidenced by the fact that creativity cannot take a single step forward without fear marching right alongside it. And one of the important things that she points out is when we try to dampen our fear, we lose our creativity too. I think this is one of the things that's so important about this concept of creative living. You could see it in what I read you on the back, is it embraces all of us and all of life. It's the light and the dark. It's the bravery and the fear. And I think that's what Elizabeth is grappling with in this book. I love the metaphor she used for bringing fear and courage together on a road trip. And she tells fear, yes, you can absolutely come, but you cannot drive the car. So I wonder what our creative lives are like when we tell fear that she is allowed, she is real, we see her, we hear her, but she's not in charge of setting our destination or getting us there. Something wonderful to think about. And reading this and then picking up also Rising Strong, The Reckoning, The Rumble, The Revolution by Brené Brown, I can fully understand why Brené and Elizabeth have been doing a lot of appearances together, because there's this wonderful theme of showing up fully and allowing for all the tough stuff and not letting it stop you. I think this is one of the underlying themes always in Brené's work, is opening up the fullness of human experience and choosing to live our lives wholeheartedly. One of the things she said here is, I've come to believe that we all want to show up and be seen in our lives. This means we will all struggle and fall. We will know what it means to be both brave and brokenhearted. See, again, that richness, that fullness, that what I like to call full spectrum living, is a part of embracing our wholeness and our creative lives. One of the things I really appreciate in both these books is when the authors share their own experience with these big questions. And I feel so inspired by what Brené says herself. I want to be in the arena. I want to be brave with my life. And when we make the choice to dare greatly, we sign up to get our asses kicked. We can choose courage or we can choose comfort, but we can't have both, not at the same time. Vulnerability is not winning or losing. It's having the courage to show up and be seen when we have no control of the outcome. This is another one of those places where I feel our creativity and our lives mirror one another. How bravely we can show up to our art and see and experiences where we fall short and not let that stop us, but instead to see that as a part of the experience, to learn from it, to grow. And also one of the gifts that our creativity can give us is a way of holding and being with both our rise and fall, both our bravery and our brokenheartedness. Our poems can hold that, our paintings can hold that, our dance can hold all of that. And when we create those containers for that range of life experience, I think that it allows us to process them and hold them, and also to remind one another to do the same. So I think there is lots to learn from Brené Brown in this idea of rising strong. That just takes me, I'm going to switch around the order here, because that really took me to these two books that I am reading by Cat Bennett. And I've got to tell you, I have been unable to put them down. In fact, I only put down one to pick up the other. So the two books I'm reading by Cat Bennett are The Drawing Club of Improbable Dreams, How to Create a Club for Art, and Making Art a Practice, 30 Ways to Paint a Pipe, How to Be the Artist You Are. So I was very lucky to be able to recently take Art as Practice class with Cat recently through Carla Sondheim, and just loved her approach, and that made me first get this book and then just immediately after get the Drawing Club book. And where I see a relationship between what Brené is saying and what Kat is saying is in that ability to embrace the wholeness of our creative selves, our ability to embrace, accept, be compassionate with what shows up in our work, and to show up every day to our art practice. One chapter that captures this so beautifully is titled Loving Where We Are. There's no map for artists. Ours are individual journeys, no two the same. In our art making too, none of us knows just how things will unfold until they do. We may have a vision or a clear idea, but art evolves in the making. It's like life evolves in the living. Sometimes we take stock of where we are and we may be disappointed. We haven't painted the ceiling of the Sistine Chapel or traveled to Tahiti. If we lose our heads, and we will from time to time, we might find fault with ourselves. We might think we've failed, and we may well have failed to see who we are. The Sistine Chapel simply doesn't have our name on it, but something does. We'll discover that something in our art practice. That is one of its goals. We might see that our gifts are limited. They are. But we're not alone. Michelangelo did not do embroidery. I love that line. That line stopped me in the tracks. If you follow me on Facebook and Twitter, you saw it there, because I was laughing when I read that. The things I love that Kat is offering here, and to me, it is an offering that responds so beautifully to what Brené and Elizabeth are bringing up, is creating our art practice and allowing our creative impulses to unfold before us freely, openly, and wholeheartedly. One of my favorite things as I'm reading this book is to gather all of the things that Kat specifically lays out as a part of that practice. For example, one thing she says is, our practice is to be true to ourselves. This will take us farther than anything we imagine. And another one that really caught my ear in here was, our practice is to follow immediately where our impulses take us. And as somebody with a background in theater, I recognize that place where you have an impulse and your job is to show up to that impulse, to follow it, to not allow that inner censor to stop you or assess it or edit it, but instead to let it be raw and pure and real and offer it up immediately. I think if you are really ready to embrace a creative life, if you're interested in pursuing your art, this is a beautiful way to help you create a compassionate, useful, practical practice for developing not only your work, but also yourself as an artist. And one of the ways you might want to do that is to create your own drawing club, which is what Kat discusses here. She runs a Saturday morning drawing club, and she's been doing so for years. And one of the things I love in this book is she is very generous with exactly how she has approached that, what she's learned, and, you know, what do you need for a space to have a drawing club? What supplies do you need for a drawing club? What kind of guidelines do you need for a drawing club? The core big golden rule in her drawing club that developed shortly after her beginning was this. She calls it our one rule. Now to our one rule. We will only look for the good in our work. Instead of looking for what's wrong, we'll look for what's strong, for what's beautiful and unique. We can build on our strengths if we know what they are. And if we build on our strengths, they'll overcome whatever is weak. And I think about creative living, I'm always looking for that crossover between our creativity and the way we live our lives. So imagine this in your creative work and imagine this in showing up for your life. What would happen if you always looked, instead of for what's wrong, for what's strong? What might open up? What might build? What might shift? What might grow? So one of the things that is so beautiful too in this book, not only does Kat give you the philosophy behind the approach to start a drawing club, it is also about midway through, it transitions into exercises that you can do. So if you wanted to grab some friends and decide that together you would meet up and do drawing exercises, that you would be compassionate with one another, you would not look for what's wrong, but look for what's strong. I wonder what would unfold after 10 weeks of that practice. If you do it, let me know. I'd be so curious. In a different realm, I have just picked up, so I haven't started this very much at all, The Art of Memoir by Mary Karr. And Mary Karr is well known as an expert in the field of memoir. And one of the things I'm really looking forward to is at the back she has a whole list of essential memoirs she recommends you read. Mary teaches memoir at university, and you can feel the intellectual rigor of what she is offering. One of the things I think is really interesting about this book is its exploration of the relationship between memoir and story and history and memories. The sheer nature of how our memories work and how we tell our stories. You know, one of the things she says is, I come from a family of storytellers, and it's true that having a close group of folks retell events over and over better logs the narrative into long-term storage. But memorized language can also calcify what's in your head. Events grow stale when told by rote. Like old dough squeezed out of a pastry bag, the stories can feel too artificially shaped. And negotiated memories can be like a piece of writing clawed over by an editorial board. Anything at all dubious gets deleted and any particular point of view abolished. This really had me thinking about family stories. You know, I'm the oldest in my family. My sister Shannon is the youngest. And one of the things she often says is, I don't know if I actually remember that or I have that memory from hearing you all share this story. And that's a fascinating thing. What happens when we start telling our stories and turning them into, crafting them into a piece of work? I don't know yet. And that is one of the reasons I am really looking forward to diving into this book. One of the books I'm also diving into, oh, it's been such a fascinating experience, is, you know, there's this big trend these days for adult coloring books. And I thought, I'm going to try it. I picked up this French book, Rêves, 100 Coloriages pour s'endormir. So Dreams, 100, I assume this is things to color for sending you off to sleep, so for helping you sleep. One of the reasons that I chose this book, I'm going to bring it in a little bit closer so you can see it, was that I felt there was a really good variety in the drawings. So that there were some with an enormous amount of detail, some with less so, some that were more abstract, some that were figures. One of the things I also really appreciated was I thought, oh, for my own visual vocabulary, there were shapes in here that were simple and yet weren't ones that I would normally make. Or if you look at something like this, you know, which is giving you a whole range of feathers, as you really look at that and spend time with it, how much more familiar are you going to be with featherness? I also thought this would be a great way to explore different color stories, to just grab a few colors and say, I wonder what these are going to look like together. And I was surprised by two things when I started working in a coloring book. One was I immediately had this inner critic saying that this is not art, that this is going to lower my skill instead of increase my skill. Like somehow I would forget even the little bit I knew about drawing by trying to go inside the lines of somebody else's creation. So that story was immediately there. And in fact, I carried this around in the store for quite a while before I got past that voice, thinking, Jamie, what you should do is draw things that then you color in. What you should do is create your own art. It really took me some time to shut that aside and decide, hey, look, I want to try it. And so I'm going to. The other thing that I'm really trying to embrace is being brave and bold with my choices, so that, you know, once you've spent an hour coloring something and then you're like, oh, I need to add a new color. Is it gonna work? What if it wrecks us? What if I don't like it anymore? And that is the nature of all our creations. So I am giving myself permission in this book to even make choices I'm quite confident are going to fail. To choose things that I think just might be a little bit ugly and allow myself to get over it and also enjoy the simple physical act of coloring. There's something really joyous and incredibly meditative of just moving your hand along the page and seeing your impact. I think not only do we want to be seen, but we also want to see. We want to see a reflection of ourselves and our work. We want to see the impact that our efforts have. And I think a coloring book is a simple and meditative way to do that, even though, as I said, it wasn't quite as simple as I imagined it would be. So these are the books that are currently on my Creative Living bookshelf. I hope there is something in here that speaks to you, and I hope in particular that this theme of showing up fully and bravely and repeatedly to your creative life inspires you deeply. Thanks so much for spending this time with me. I just love it when you come and visit me here at Jamie Ridler Studios. I am Jamie. Come on by openthedoor.ca for more creative living inspiration.